Penguin Random House Audio presents The Happy Bottom Riding Club, The Life and Times of Pancho Barnes by Lauren Kessler. Read for you by Hollis McCarthy. Prologue. Pancho needed to be persuaded. She was sitting in Walton June Geisen's kitchen in Lancaster, California, a desert town 2 hours northeast of Los Angeles, drinking coffee and considering Walt's invitation. Pancho had been famous, but that was long ago. She had once owned a 35-room mansion and a sprawling oceanfront estate and a 360-acre desert oasis. She had once owned Cadillacs and racehorses, cabin cruisers and airplanes. But now, in the winter of 1970, she was just an old woman living alone in a one-room shanty with her dozens of Yorkies and Chihuahuas. When she got tired of her own company, she drove to the local post office or over to the county clerk's, stood at the counter, and talked to whoever would listen. Lately, she'd been driving into Lancaster to stop by Walt and June's. Two or three times a week, she'd show up at their door just before dinner and then act surprised when June asked her to stay for a meal. She was, in some ways, a pitiful figure, alone and broke, and if not looking for handouts, then certainly looking for company. But it was hard for Walt and June to feel sorry for Pancho, because once she sat down at the table and started talking, she was transformed. She told big, brawling, wonderful stories about the old days. Stories about Hollywood before color, before sound. Stories about the Air Force before it was the Air Force. About people she had flown with and partied with and gotten drunk with. Heroes and generals and millionaires and stars. People Walt and June had only read about. So the Geisens didn't feel they were doing Pancho a favor by giving her a free meal. They felt she was doing them a favor by sharing her past. Pancho had known Walt for more than 10 years. He was an aviation nut like her, a pilot who flew for fun, hopping in his Cessna on a Saturday morning to fly to Bakersfield for lunch, or to just tool around in the big open sky above the Mojave. Bore a hole in it, as he would say to his flying buddies. Walt's work was with airplanes too. He was an engineering supervisor at the GE Flight Test Center over at Edwards Air Force Base, just north of Lancaster. That's how Pancho knew him. Pancho's only son, Billy, worked under Walt. Over the years, Pancho and Walt had forged a casual friendship, built on these not quite impromptu dinnertime visits. Pancho had always gotten along well with men, and generally tried to tolerate the women they were married to. She actually liked June Geisen, who had raised sons and, perhaps because of that, seemed unperturbed by Pancho's X-rated jokes, indecorous yarns, and liberal use of four-letter words. That evening, in the Geisen's kitchen, Walt asked Pancho if she would be the guest speaker at the annual Experimental Aircraft Association banquet coming up next month. The local chapter was a large, enthusiastic group of men who, like Walt, lived and breathed airplanes. Pancho had been a social being to her core. She had, in her time, thrown three-day bacchanals, ridden a horse into a barroom, and hosted the biggest, loudest, wildest party the desert had ever seen. But when Walt invited her to deliver the banquet speech, she hesitated. She felt suddenly and uncharacteristically shy. She had been out of the spotlight for so long. Who would remember her? She wondered. Who would care about her adventures so many years ago? Who would want to sit and listen? For all the friends she used to have, no one came by her little house up in Boron. All her old cronies, famous and otherwise, had died or moved away or, she figured, forgotten her. She hadn't been at a public event in close to 15 years. And what, she wondered, would she wear? She was the least vain of women. Her standard attire ran to mud-caked jeans and old Western shirts. She had not worn a dress for years, never wore makeup, and rarely washed, let alone styled, what was left of her hair. But she knew she couldn't stand up in front of all those guys, those local pilots and engineers and aircraft industry bigwigs, those men in their suits and ties with their wives in high heels and cultured pearl necklaces. She couldn't stand up in front of all of them and not look good. But Walt succeeded in persuading her to deliver the banquet speech anyway. The thought that she might be, if only for an hour or so, the center of attention again was too appealing to ignore. The next day, she phoned a local woman she knew, and they spent most of the week figuring out what Pancho would wear. She had a theatrical sense of color that ran to eye-popping purple and grass green, oranges and reds and yellows, big colors that announced one's presence with a shout and a bang, not the kind of colors most 70-year-old women would wear. Pancho's friend was amazed when the outfit they came up with actually looked good. It was a wild green and purple paisley print tunic, long-sleeved and high-necked, falling straight and slim over her non-existent hips. She wore it over a pair of simple black slacks. Pancho dressed carefully that evening, January 16, 1971. She applied eyeliner and lipstick, amazed that she still knew how. She tried to do something with her wisps of graying hair, but gave up and stuck her favorite wig on her head instead. The big black curly one that gave her an abundance of hair, but also gave her that odd, surprised look old women have when they wear big dark wigs. Still, she looked good when she showed up at Walt and June's house that night. When they got to the Elks Lodge in Palmdale, they found an overflow crowd, maybe 120 people. Those who couldn't be accommodated in the banquet room sat or stood in the bar. They had all come to see and hear Pancho Barnes. Many of them had been surprised to read her name on their invitations. They knew her by reputation, of course. Everyone who knew anything about the history of aviation knew about Pancho Barnes. And they knew of her because, even in this place known for its eccentric desert characters, Pancho had loomed larger than life. She had been the talk of the Mojave since the 1930s. But most of the people who showed up that night thought she had died years before. When the meal was almost over, Ted Tate got up to introduce her. Ted was doing PR for General Dynamics over at the base. Although he had encountered Pancho years ago in her heyday, when he was a young man on the fringes of the fun, he had just recently engineered a friendship with her. He couldn't get enough of her stories. He was enamored of, almost obsessed with, the romantic life Pancho talked about having lived. A life that it was no longer possible to live. Ted had a smart and beautiful wife and four children, but he had begun to spend all his free time with Pancho. He would go over to her place and take her driving across the desert in his hopped-up T-bird with the top down. They would sit on corral fences, eat at greasy spoons, and roar around the desert, Ted driving, Pancho talking. He was so full of her stories, so much a fan, that Ted didn't really know how to introduce her. There was too much to say. Besides, he figured she could say it better than he could. So he made it short. "Here she is," he said. "I love her." Pancho walked to the podium, smiling in her big black wig and loud paisley tunic. Her face was deeply lined. 40 years of desert living etched around the eyes and mouth. She had always been a homely woman, and age did nothing to improve her looks. She looked all of her 70 years, but she also looked healthy and alive, energetic, ready to rumble, as in the old days. She grabbed the sides of the stand and waited for the applause to stop, not wanting it to, of course. She had no idea what she was going to say. She hadn't prepared a speech. But talking was what she did best, so she trusted herself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.